Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath, everybody. It's good to be with you still today. I've had a great time today, having conversation, eating haystacks, and of course, sharing the Word of God with you. This is our last time this weekend, so tear. No, seriously. I'm gonna miss all of you. Come again? Mercy, mercy, mercy. All right. Somebody heard her. I was going to speak on another topic today, but over the course of the afternoon and just hearing different conversations, I felt led to go in this direction. I still believe that it works with our theme for the year, for the weekend. For my church, we have a theme for the year, so I keep saying theme for the year. I hope that I pray that it is a blessing to all of us. This message is entitled Contracts and Covenants. Can you say Contracts and Covenants?
Contracts and Covenants.
Contracts and Covenants. We're going to read Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 to 5. Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 to 5. The Bible says, "After this, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward." It's interesting how you start learning certain things in Scripture, and then you go back and you read other things, and you're like, man, God keeps saying, I am these things. He doesn't keep saying that I'm going to provide these things. Sometimes he says that, but I also take notice of when he says, "Do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield, your very great reward." But Abram said, "Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? And the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus." Eliezer was a servant of Abraham, and Abraham had gotten in his head that maybe Eliezer could be his heir, that Eliezer could pass on his lineage. And Abram said, "You have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. Because I have no kids, I'm going to have to leave everything to one of my servants." Then the word of the Lord came to him, "This man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir." Verse 5 concludes by saying this, "He took him outside and said, 'Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them.' Then he said to him, 'So shall your offspring be.'" Let us pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we're thankful for the promises that were given to Abraham that have been passed down to us. Lord, we're thankful that we have an opportunity to continue to commune with you. We ask that you'd be with us and bless us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, in order to know what is happening in this story, you have to know that Abraham has been called out of his home country, Ur, and he has been called to a land that he does not know. The Lord told him that he would go there and God would show him the land that he would eventually inherit, or that his offspring would inherit. And Abraham is now in a position where he is totally dependent upon God. He has been pulled away from his family. He has been called away from his community, and he has to totally rely on God for survival. If he does not trust in God, if he does not rely on God, if God does not provide for him, if God is not there to protect him, Abraham will die. Now, as Abraham has done this, he has gone there with his wife Sarah, his nephew Lot, Lot's wife, and they are there, and he is hoping and praying that they will have children. And you can imagine that when Abraham and Sarah got married, that they had all of the hopes and all of the dreams that most people have when they get married. I believe that if they had had Facebook in that time, that they would have posted an engagement photo shoot, that maybe if Sarah wore a ring, that there would have been a ring, that there would have been lots of excitement. In fact, what we go through as single people, youth and young adults, is that as we're growing up, people ask us, "Oh, when are you going to graduate?" And you tell them, "Okay, this is when I'm going to graduate." You think you're done. No. Right after you graduate, they say, "Where's the husband? Where's the wife?" Right? And then they're pushing for that. So then, trust me, as a single pastor, I've heard the speeches. And then they're expecting, for you to get married. And then you get married and you think, "Okay, they're going to leave me alone." They say, no, "Where are the kids?" And you're like, "Okay." So then you finally have one kid. They said, "Where's the next one?" And then you have the second kid. And then you have the third. And they say, whoa, "Slow down. You're having too many." Or you get to a fourth. And I realize you can't live for other people's expectations. But Abraham and Sarah here have an expectation that they will one day have children. And Abraham, in conversation with God here, is wondering, what's going on, God? I'm here, you're telling me that I will have offspring, you're telling me that my offspring will be as the stars in the sky if I can count them, yet I can't even start counting because I don't even have one child. And he's asking God for proof. He was asking God for evidence. He's asking God for a reason to believe that the promise will come to pass, because what Abraham sees is not in alignment with what God has said. He's wondering, how is God going to make this come to pass? Because I am getting older and my wife is getting older as well. The Bible tells us in verse 6, it says, Abraham believed the Lord and he credited it to him as righteousness. Abraham did what? He believed the Lord. And what was given to him as righteousness? Oh, sorry, how was it given to him as righteousness? Do you know what credit is? How many of us know what credit is? All right. Some of us don't know what credit is. God bless you. Credit is unearned cash. You sign up and they say, we're going to just give this to you. Now you have to pay it back, but it's just given to you. Now that's financial credit, but when something is credited to you, it means that you have done nothing to earn it. You have done nothing to merit it. In fact, I encourage you all when you study the book of Romans, study Romans chapter 4, because Romans 4 echoes this very same verse. And it says that Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. And now I hope we understand what it's saying here. It's not saying that Abraham was righteous because he believed God. It's saying that when Abraham believed God, he still wasn't worthy of being righteous, but God decided to credit to him righteousness. Abraham didn't change his diet. Abraham didn't start going to church on a certain day. Abraham didn't do a lot of the things that we think we need to do in order to be saved. He believed God, and it was credited to him for righteousness. Now, please don't confuse anything that I'm saying to say that those things are not important. They are important, but they are not the thing that gain righteousness for us. Pastor, what do you mean? No, I've been told that, you know, if I do the right thing, then I will go to heaven. I've been told that, you know, I should do this and walk this way and talk this way and eat this way and go to church on this day and do it like this. And if I do all of these things and I memorize these Elamite books and I memorize all of these quotes and I live this way and I do it like that, then I'm good, then I'm sealed, then I'm perfect, then I'm ready. But the Bible tells us here that Abraham believed God, he believed the Lord, and it was credited to him for righteousness. A lot of us have an understanding of how we gain righteousness that is influenced by how the world works. What do I mean? So I remember when I was younger, I got my very first job, and I got a job. Where was this job? Ah, this job was on the campus of Andrews University. It wasn't my first job, but it was my first job that didn't pay me right away. So I got the job, and I needed money. I had gotten to a point where I said, I need to work this thing out. I need to get some cash. So I applied. I went in with my church suit. I got the job. I was excited. And I'm figuring, okay, I need money now to pay the bills. So I start working the first week, and I just kind of just wait around on Friday wondering, like, okay, how is this payment process going to happen here? I check my bank account. Nothing there. And I went and I kind of approached them and I said, so I just want to know what to expect, you know, because I don't want to be too forthcoming with my request here. And they said, well, you know, we pay every 2 weeks. So I said, okay, Lord, I need to make it one more week. Let's just make this work. Finally, the 2 weeks came and I got my check. And a lot of us think that salvation happens the very same way, that the check being salvation is that we show up and we work. And we go to church, and we're a deacon, we're an elder, we memorize scripture, we eat the right thing, we don't curse, we do all of these things. And if we're good, then we get the check, and then we're saved. But that's not the way salvation works. The way that salvation works is that it is credited to us. In other words, before you start working, you get your check. Before you show up for work, you get your check. And now, you don't work in order to get the check, but you work because you have the check. In other words, because I'm saved, now I'm going to keep the Sabbath and I'm going to walk right and I'm going to memorize scripture and I'm going to walk with the Lord and I'm going to be a faithful husband, a faithful wife, all of those things. Not in order to be saved, but with the recognition that I already am saved. Amen. See, a lot of us believe that we have to earn our place with God. We have to work our way into heaven. So we sweat and we're stressed out and we're like, Lord, I'm still struggling with this. I don't understand how this promise that you have given me is going to come to pass because I see how I am and I see who I am and I see the struggle that I'm going through right now. The Bible tells us Abraham believed the Lord and he credited it to him as righteousness. He also said to him, I am the Lord who bought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. But Abraham said, and now Abraham is contending because Abraham, I believe, is 99. His wife is 90. The physical things around him do not help him believe what God is saying. He's looking for evidence, but the evidence just is not adding up. It says, but Abraham said, Sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain it? Like, I know, God, I know you said it, and I want to believe you, but I need some proof. How do I know for sure? Ellen White, on Righteousness by Faith, I want to read this for you. She says, we must learn in the school of Christ, nothing but his righteousness can entitle us to one of the blessings of the covenant of grace. Nothing. Listen, we are in an Adventist church. I don't know if everybody here is Adventist, but I run into, on a regular basis, people who are convinced that if you do not know a certain thing, then you're not sealed, you're not saved, you're not ready. And what it sounds like is that in order to be sealed, saved, ready, you have to go and do this. You have to go and learn this. You have to stop this. Again, we're not saying that those things are not important, but they have to know their place. Those things have a certain place. You do those things because you're saved, not in order to earn salvation, not in order to prove your righteousness. She says, we must learn in the school of Christ, nothing but his righteousness can entitle us, make us worthy of, make it so that we are owed, can entitle us to one of the blessings of the covenant of grace. We have long desired and tried to obtain these blessings, but have not received them because we have cherished the idea that we could do something to make ourselves worthy of them. My brethren, are you expecting that your merit will recommend you to the favor of God, thinking that you must be free from sin before you trust his power to save? This is Ellen White. She says, you think that you have to be free from sin before you trust his power to save? That's not the way it works. You trust his power to save in order to be free of sin. Amen. You don't try to say, okay, I'm going to stop eating this. I'm going to stop watching this. I'm going to stop doing that. I'm going to stop. And then he'll save. No, no. You trust that he's already saved you. She goes on to say, if this is the struggle going on in your mind, I fear you will gain no strength and will finally become discouraged. There's a reason why. Oh. No, no. There's a reason why there are certain people in the church who just can't be happy. Like you would expect with the relationship that they act like they have, there should be some joy there. But there's no joy. If this is a struggle going on in your mind, I fear you will gain no strength and will finally become discouraged. There's a confidence that we should have in the saving power of Jesus Christ. And I recognize that we don't develop a kind of language that lends itself to this because there are other faiths that say once saved, always saved. They act like it's, you know, like it's nothing, you know? So in order to stay away from that, there's a language that's developed that sounds unsure. We ask people, are you saved? I think. Jesus died on the cross. You believe that he died on the cross for you. His blood was shed for you. You're saved. You believe in him. You're in a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. You can say that with confidence. Well, I think. Based on how I was last week, I'm not really sure. You know? In fact, one of the things I run into often as I'm pastoring is a member will call me and say, "Pastor, I know I'm supposed to do intercessory prayer, or I know I'm supposed to do call to worship, or I know I'm supposed to serve it with AY, but I can't because I got some stuff going on." And I asked them, I said, "You think that the pastor's perfect every time he gets up to preach? You think that the way that I act can recommend me to do the job that I do? Of course, I try to walk sanctified. I try to walk worthy. I try to walk holy. But if I'm relying upon my own performance to make me worthy, then I should drop the mic and everything right now. You will never reach a place where you are holy, perfect, sanctified enough to do what God has called you to do. You will always be unworthy. And it's nothing but His grace that will carry you through." She goes on and she says, "Some seem to feel that they must be on probation and must prove to the Lord that they are reformed before they can claim His blessing. But these dear souls may claim the blessing even now." Amen. She says, these dear souls may claim the blessing even now. You do not have to wait till you work Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and then get the check. Before you start working, you've received the check of salvation. It is yours. And because it is yours, you say, "I'll be faithful to the Lord." So another example of it is like this. It's like two people who get married. They get married, and he says, "All right, well, now that we're married, then I'm going to show you all of this love." Now, beforehand, he could have been doing all of that. But now he's in a situation where he's worked in order to gain all of these things, and he's working to earn her affection, and he's working to gain all of the love. And while that is good, the marriage covenant in and of itself should be enough for him to say, "I'm going to get her flowers. I'm going to care for her. I'm going to be in true and real and true and loving and real relationship with her." Even if he's not as happy as he thought he would be, or things are not working out in the way that he thought that they would work out. As we look at the story of Abraham here, the Bible says, "So the Lord said to him, 'Bring me a heifer, a goat, a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon.'" Now, this is the Lord speaking to Abraham. And what the Lord is doing here is that he's about to cut a covenant with Abraham. Can you say, "Cut a covenant"? Cut a covenant. You're like, what is that? What is cutting a covenant? Well, in Abraham's time, there was a way that they made covenants. And covenants were different from contracts. Covenants were promises that should never be broken. Contracts are those things where, you know, there are the exceptions, there are the terms and the conditions. You know, if these things are not done in a certain way at a certain time, then the contract is null and void. Whereas covenants are saying, no matter what happens, we're going to keep our word here. And he was about to cut a covenant. Now, the way that they cut a covenant here was, and this is something that would happen. In fact, I think, let me find a reference scripture for all of you so that you can do your research later on and know that Pastor was telling you the truth. I'm trying to find it. I don't remember it right now. So I'll text it to Jennifer Silva, and then she'll share it with you guys next week. For some reason, my mind is, Jeremiah 38, verse 14. Boom. There we go. So the way that they made covenants back in that time would be that they would take animals, and they would cut the animals in half. Ooh, right? I only had one person say, the rest of us eat meat, huh? Okay, so you you think dinner. Okay. So they would cut the animals in half. And when you cut an animal, what comes out of the animal? Blood, right? Guts and all of those things. So they would cut the animal right down the middle in half, and they would lay the animal by the halves on each side. So when God is telling Abraham now, gather these animals, Abraham understands what's about to happen. He's asked God for proof. He says, God, how do I know? How am I sure that this thing is going to come to pass? And God, in response, says, okay, Abraham, go gather these animals. And if you study this, these are the very same animals that are used in the sanctuary service. So he says, bring me a heifer, a goat, a ram, each 3 years old. How long was Jesus' ministry? Okay. With a dove and a young pigeon. He says, Abraham, bring these things. Abraham brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. So can you see the bloody trail that has now been left because Abraham has cut these animals in half and he's laid them on each side, one next to another? Do we see it? What's in the middle of this path? Blood. Now, when people were cutting the covenant, this is what they would do. They would cut the animals in half and they would walk through the bloody trail. And when they walk through the bloody trail, that's how they sealed the covenant. And they were essentially saying, if I do not keep my word, let it be done to me what has been done to these animals. So one person would walk through, and then the other person would walk through as well. Essentially saying, I should die if I don't keep my word. And both parties would end up walking through. Now, Abraham has asked the question, God, how do I know? Like, how do I know for sure that you're going to keep your word? I'm 90 years old. I'm 99. My wife is 90. We are physically beyond the point where we can produce the promise ourselves. The same way we in and of ourselves cannot produce salvation ourselves. See, there's a reason why God waited till Abraham was 99 and Sarah was 90. He could have done it when they were 30. He could have done it when they were 40. He could have done it when they were 50. But if he had waited and he had done it then, they might have said, you know what? We did this. See, sometimes our blessings are delayed because God wants to be able to take all of the credit and all of the glory for what happened. A lot of us, we hinder the testimony because we say, oh, yeah, well, you know, yeah, I studied hard. No. Yeah, you might have, but it's still the grace of God that brought you through. So God tells him to bring these, and he cuts them in half. And it says, then the birds of prey came down on the carcass, but Abram drove them away. Now, in order to see this, it's the birds are circling. They're seeing this bloody mess here, and they want to come down, and they want to consume the sign of the promise. The very same way, when God has promised you something, and you're trusting in God, and you're relying on God, there will be ravens, there will be vultures, there will be people and situations in your life that will come and try to destroy it, that will come and try to take it away, that will come and try to discourage you, that will come and tell you that it's not going to happen for you. You should move on. You should stop waiting on God. You should stop trusting in God. Even the ravens might be manifested within your own heart as you start thinking about these things, and you're wondering, maybe I shouldn't keep trusting in God. But Abraham, the Bible says, drove them away. It is your responsibility to protect the promise that God has given you. You will face discouragement. You will face times where you wonder, God, is it really going to happen? But Abraham drove them away. It says, as the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep and a thick, dreadful darkness came over him. The Lord said to him, know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. Does this sound familiar? Who's this? Israelites in Egypt. So God is now telling him, look, I'm showing you the proof that this is going to happen, but Abraham, you're not going to see it happen in your generation. He says, know for certain that for 400 years, your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age. This is why I said there are certain promises we're only going to see fulfilled when Jesus comes again. God is telling Abraham, look, I'm going to keep my word, but you're not going to see a lot of this happen. You're going to die. You're going to go and be buried with your fathers at a good old age, but I'm still going to keep my word. Not even your death will keep God from being faithful. And then he says, in the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. Do you guys see what's happening here in this verse? Like, all right, as I'm reading this, and I'm thinking I'm Abraham as I read, right? And I'm like, okay, God, you just told me I'm going to die before you keep your word. Like, really, God? Okay. All right, fine. I trust you. But my descendants for 400 years are going to be enslaved? God, why? Why is this going to happen to them? Why is it that they have to suffer all of this time? before you keep your promise? And God answers that question in verse 16 when he says, in the fourth generation, in what generation? Your descendants will come back here. Why? For the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. In other words, what he's saying is that these Amorites over here, they haven't yet gotten to the point where they have fully rebelled and they have put themselves completely out of the reach of my grace. And because of that, I need you and your people to wait. He says for 400 years, they're going to be enslaved. And then in the fourth generation, then I'll bring them out. Why? Because the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. In other words, God is working on these people, trying to save them. And in the process of doing that, he has to delay blessings to his own children. All of us have been Amorites at one point or another. How many blessings did your parents miss out on so that you could make it to this country? How many blessings did others miss out on in order for you to gain an education, in order for you to gain some finances, in order for you to get an opportunity to hear the gospel? What blessings were delayed for others? Because God called them to wait. And vice versa. When God calls you, sometimes he calls us to wait as well. Now, waiting is tough. I got a church over there. It's not easy. It's not easy. Like, one of the toughest experiences in world, well, not, maybe not, one of the first world, tough, one of the toughest first world experiences you can have is sitting in the waiting room. Yeah, right? Because once you've gotten to the waiting room, you know, you've tried all of your natural remedies, you've eaten the lemon ginger echinacea and all of those things, you've taken the hot and the cold shower, you've tried it all, right? And nothing is working. And finally you say, I need to go see a doctor. So then in your state of emergency, you go to the doctor and you're sitting in the doctor's office now. And the tough thing with sitting in the doctor's office is that you know you have a great need, but the doctor still won't see you right away. And now you have to wait. And not only are you waiting in the doctor's office, but you're waiting around other people who are sick as well. And you can contract what they have. The waiting room is a very dangerous place. Not only is the waiting room dangerous because there are other people who are waiting that can get that can pass on what they have as well, but the toughest thing about the waiting room is that the doctor will come out and call somebody's name that's not your name. And now you have to see other people being blessed while you're still waiting to get blessed. And you know that your need is dire. You know that your need is extreme. And you're just hoping that one day the doctor will call my name and that the blessing that I've been waiting for will finally come through. And finally, the doctor comes in and calls your name. You perk up and stand up and you look around and looks like I've been chosen. I mean, you go and you say farewell to all you sickly people. I will see you. I'm going to go see the doctor now. Only to go and sit in another smaller waiting room. It's challenging. It's challenging to be in the waiting room. Because when you're in the waiting room, you know, you can become disassociated from the promise. Some of us have prayed prayers and forgot that we prayed the prayer. And then when God answers, we don't remember that we prayed about these things. That's why it's so important to journal your prayers. Because it's easy to forget. It's easy to give up and say, this isn't going to happen. And then God blesses you 6 years later. You don't even know to thank him because you don't remember that you prayed for it. While you're waiting, you can become disassociated or even disenchanted with the promise. You can catch what other people have, their lack of faith, their doubts, their issues. And then you could be tempted to give up because other people are being blessed while you're still waiting to get blessed. Other people are getting into the schools. Other people are getting the jobs. Other people are getting the opportunities. And you're still waiting on your own. God tells Abraham, I need you to wait. I know it's hard. I know it's not easy, but I'm working on other people as well. I want the Amorites to be saved. I want to give them every single opportunity to hear the gospel. So I need you to wait. if I were to give you what you asked for right now, others would have to suffer. Growing up, I used to wake up really early to catch the bus, and I would want on certain days, especially when it's raining or snowing, for the bus to come right away and to just pick me up and just take me straight to where I wanted to go, not even stop for anybody else. I was selfish like that. But God is good. I'm not who I used to be. But the bus driver is only successful if the bus driver makes every single stop. And if the bus driver is making every single stop, that means I might have to wait a little while in order to get on. But I don't want to just get to the destination by myself. I want everybody there with me as well. Amen? It says, when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. Many times in scripture, there's not enough time to show you all the scriptures, but Jesus and God show up as fire, burning bush, you know, many other times. And here we see, it says, when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot and a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. Do you remember what I said? Passing between the pieces means? It means, if I don't keep my word to you, then let it be done to me what has been done to these animals. And the Bible tells us that the Lord appeared as a smoking fire pot, as a torch, and passed through the pieces. Now, there's an amen right there. You missed it. Amen. Okay. But watch Abraham pass through the pieces. Oh, hold on. Are you guys seeing what I'm seeing? Except, what was that? Abraham did not go through the pieces. Only God went through the pieces. The way a covenant was cut before was that both parties would go and the covenant would be based on both parties keeping their parts. God passed through and he said, it's over. I am not asking you to pass through. God says, I'm going to get it done on my own. There was no Abraham passing through the pieces. For him to say, okay, if I live right, if I do these things, then I can gain the promise. God said, no, I'm going to secure the promise. I'm going to send my son. He's going to die. I'm going to pass through the pieces. And if I don't keep my word to you, then let it be done to me what has been done to these animals. It is not dependent upon the behavior or the performance of Abraham. The same way salvation is not dependent upon your behavior or your performance. It's dependent upon your belief. Amen. Now, true belief leads to performance, right? Amen. So the analogy, I don't think I made it very well before, is the husband who says, I love my wife. Now, because he loves his wife, he treats her right. He loves her. He cares for her. He does all of these things, not in order to learn to love her, because he's already chosen to love her. He's made a covenant. That's why they call marriage a covenant, not a contract. I mean, some people, they call it a contract. You know, the world calls it a contract. It's a covenant. It's a covenant. It's not supposed to be broken. It is supposed to endure. There should not be terms and conditions. If he looks this way, if he stays this height, if he stays this weight, you know, if you know, all of those terms and conditions, then I will love him. No. No. If he has this job, if she cooks. Oh, I had to go for the men as well. I'm sorry. Covenant. Now, because they love each other, they do all of this extra stuff as a sign of that love. It says, on that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham and said, to your descendants, I give this land. God made a covenant with Abraham. He passed through. He didn't ask Abraham to pass through. All Abraham had to do was believe, and it was credited to him as righteousness. There was nothing else that needed to happen. And because he believed, he was supposed to go on and do all of the right things. The message is still the same for us today. I grew up in fear. Like, oh man, all right, I got to do this. I got to do it this way at that time, and et cetera, et cetera. The issue with fear is that fear wears off. Eventually, you leave home. Eventually, you're not in the condition that caused you to be afraid anymore. And you find out, I'm okay. I'm not as excited. I'm not as fearful. I did it once, and nothing happened. So, yeah, don't say amen. Don't blow your spot. That's my job to do, because I'm going back to the States tomorrow. The Bible tells us that it was credited to him for righteousness, and that the Lord made a covenant with him, and that he promised to pass it on to his descendants. Now we know, or we will learn now, that we are spiritual Israel, that the promise that is given to us is not for land here on this earth, but for a spiritual Canaan, for a Canaan that we have not yet seen. But the same promise that is given to Abraham here is given to us as well. As you wait on God, you're going to have the same questions. God, how do I know? God says, I would rather die than not keep my word. And the irony of God is that he said that, and then he still chose to die to keep his word. It is not based upon your performance. It is not based on what you can do. Because you love him, because he loves you, we ought to do these things. I find that the love and the grace of God is very much like a GPS, in that, you know, you punch in the destination and you start to drive. And you're going and you're going, and God says, okay, go two blocks up and make a right on Righteousness Avenue. And then you see Lust Lane. You say, no, Lord. And then you go that way. Now, I don't know if you guys remember the days of MapQuest. MapQuest will put you through it, because MapQuest would give you the instructions. You had to print them out before you went anywhere, right? And then you would hope to follow the instructions. And if you made a mistake, you wouldn't even know that you made a mistake until you got to the next point and you realized, hold on, it said in 0.5 miles I should make a right. I've been going for 3 miles. I don't see this right. And then what you do with MapQuest is that you have to go all the way back to the place where you made the mistake in order to try and fix it and get on the right path. Now, in your social relationships, you often have to do that. You have to go back to that place and fix that situation. But with God, God's grace is more like a GPS. It's not really like MapQuest. Because when you're driving and you make that left that you shouldn't have made, or you were disobedient and you do these things that you should not do, what does the GPS say? And that's the grace of God. Whereas the mistakes happen, and don't make the mistakes. Don't say, oh, well, God is just going to recalculate. No. He will recalculate, but you will burn more gas. You're going to put more mileage on your car. You're going to hit more speed bumps. There are going to be issues because you did not follow the right path. God will keep recalculating, but you will suffer consequences for going the wrong way. But the grace of God is like a GPS, constantly recalculating you, telling you, all right, make a U-turn, go back the right way, calling you back. And my prayer is that over the course of this weekend, you have heard the voice of God telling you to recalculate, telling you to get back on the right path, calling you to do what he has called you to do. I believe that over the course of this weekend, we have had an opportunity to realign ourselves with the will of God, with the plan and the purpose that he has for us. Some of us have been so caught up and consumed with our own dreams and our own pursuits, and we haven't really seen the plan that God has had for our lives. But it is never too late, not while you can still draw breath, to turn back and to start walking with him in the way that he has called you to walk with him. You and I both know that we can wear the nice clothes, speak the right way, and cause people to think that we're more spiritual than what we really are. In fact, if you've grown up in the church, you know that if you're polite and nobody hears anything about you, and you can quote a little bit of scripture, you're good. You're good. Everybody, oh, yeah, youth leader, make them that. I'm sure Sister Silva is above and beyond all of those things. But you know, we can work the system. We can play the games. But God is calling us to more than that. He's calling us to more than that. And you know whether or not he's been calling you to recalculate, to get back on the right path, to do the right thing, to go above and to go beyond. There's a purpose that God has for your life. And you will never experience the full power of God until you start walking in it. So if you know that God has been calling you to walk in this purpose in a new and a bold and a radical way, in a way that makes other people uncomfortable because they're used to being lukewarm, because they're used to going by the status quo, and you doing the right thing is going to convict them. If you want to walk in the purpose of God in that kind of way, the kind of way that scares you, the kind of way that you've been putting off and delaying and saying, well, when I graduate or when I get married or when I get older, that kind of way, if you know that God has been calling you to that, and today you want to take a stand and say, Lord, I no longer want to harden my heart, but I want to submit my will to yours fully. If that's you, I'll just ask for you to stand to your feet and I'll pray for you. God bless you. God bless you. I'm already standing, but I would need to stand if I were sitting, just so you know. Let us pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we're so thankful, God, that you have made covenants with us, not contracts. For Lord, if they were contracts and we had to maintain the terms and conditions, Lord, we would never be able to receive the reward. But Father, we're so thankful that you decided to make a covenant, that your faithfulness to us was not dependent upon our faithfulness to you, that you sent your Son to die for us and to rise again to give us newness of life. Father, we thank you for such great love, such redeeming love. Lord, many of us have been waiting for certain promises to be fulfilled, and as we have been in the waiting room, we have developed concerns. Some of us have even forgotten to wait for certain blessings. Some of us have developed doubts, and we wonder, how do we know that it will come to pass? But God, today we are reminded that your word cannot fail, that what you say must come to pass, that you would rather die than not be faithful to your own word, Father. So, Lord, we're so thankful that we can place our faith in you, whose strength does not waver, whose love does not fade. Lord, as we are standing, we are recommitting our lives to you in a special way. Lord, we know the ways that we have been continuously falling short. But today we want to stand understanding that we are already saved, already chosen, already loved, already redeemed. And in recognition of the love that you have poured out, God, we want to respond to that love with lives that are fully poured out to fulfill the mission that you have placed upon us. God, in order to do that, some of us have to have some difficult conversations. We have to reconcile with those that we haven't spoken to for weeks, for months, for years. We have to end relationships that should have ended a long time ago. We have to start ministries, walk away from opportunities. Lord, you know what it is that you've been calling us to do. So, Lord, I ask that you would place in our hearts and in our minds a constant reminder of the call. Lord, do not allow us to have peace outside of the purpose that you've given us, Lord. I ask that you would sabotage every plan, every endeavor that is not according to your will. Every plan that we might have for this evening, tomorrow, or the weeks or years to come, Lord. We ask that those doors might be closed, that those opportunities might be destroyed, Lord, so that we can only find the path that you have ordained for us, Father. Lord, we ask that you might continue to work with us, save us, sanctify us, bless our friends, our families, those that we know, work with, go to school with, live with, who have not come to fully know you yet. Lord, please give us the grace for our words as we minister. Show us how to act towards them. Help us to meet their need. And Lord, I ask that you'd bless this church in a very special way, God. I thank you for the call that you've placed upon them, the purpose you've placed upon them in this community. Lord, help them not to be satisfied with Adventists showing up to Adventist events. But Lord, I ask that you might give them a burden for the next door neighbor and for the coworker and for the people living around here, Lord. God, empower them to go above and beyond, to do the extraordinary, to reach these people. And Father, I ask that your spirit might continue to abide with them, that you might continue to go before them and prepare the way, and also follow them and leave blessings behind. All of these things we pray and we claim in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 God bless you. God bless you.